Y'all doing all right? It is so good to see you. For those of you who may be visiting with us for the first time or the first time in a while, you might have noticed that it is very crowded in here. First of all, I want to say I'm so glad that you're here, and I'm sorry you have to get so close to strangers, but my prayer is that you'll make some friends. I do want to let you know we are working on opening space in the new auditorium, the new commons. We've had 30, 40 contractors in there every single day trying to get that opened mid-September. So again, thank you so much for your patience with that. We did make some adjustments in our parking lot, so that should be a little bit easier. By adjustments, I pretty much said anyone who would listen to me, I had them park up on the hill. And so it gave you a little bit more space in the parking lot. Super glad that you're here. Today, we're going to be closing out a series that we started. Can you believe it? It's been 8 weeks where we've been taking a look at the stories of Jesus. Now, Jesus understood human nature. The Bible says he was 100% man and 100% God. He knew how to make us remember things. Parables are stories that Jesus would tell because he knew we would remember stories more than facts and figures, more than doctrinal statements. These stories would literally shape the way we thought. And so at the beginning of his ministry, he's comparing and contrasting the kingdom of the world and the kingdom of heaven. And he's teaching his disciples to think differently about the world around them. Now, this is very interesting, but the Bible says that we can only be where we are. We know that, right? The Bible says, although we are in this world, we're not to be of this world. What that means is our feet are on the ground, but our eyes are thinking are supposed to be higher, meaning that we're moving towards Christ. You know, Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to the patterns and behaviors of this world. Okay, but you are to be conformed to the image and the person of Jesus. These parables teach us how to think differently. You know, as we go into the fall, there are so many things that you could do. You're going to be bombarded, if you haven't already been, with all of the things you can devote and spend your time on. My encouragement to you is spend time in God's Word, hearing God's Word with spiritual family, and plant it into the church. If there was ever a time to download the Vintage Church app, you need to do it now. We update it all the time. If there was ever a time to bookmark the website, right, to get text updates, all of that, you want to make sure that you're staying connected to the Lord, connected to the ways and will of God. Make sure that you do that. A few things I want to bring up before we jump into our last parable. Don't worry, it's the shortest of all the parables, and perhaps has the biggest punch for us going into the fall, which I'm very, very excited about. A couple things that I want to draw your attention to. Guys, we are going to do a men's retreat called Fish Camp. Okay, we're going to do some deep sea fishing. Okay, I'm going to do some workshops for men. We have a few spots open. We actually were able to expand it a little bit because of demand, and so we have a couple weeks. Okay, after the last service next week, we're going to shut off all registration. This is going to be an overnight. It's going to be a whole lot of fun. My goal is to bring back at least 90% of the guys we take. Come on. I think that's a pretty good strategy. There's going to be plenty of adventure, and I promise you guys, this ain't going to be counseling sessions. We're going to sit around talking about how each other feels. We're going to learn what the Bible says about certain things. We're going to spend time together. It's going to be a lot of fun. My prayer is really that you'd meet a couple guys. You don't have to talk to everybody, okay, but that you would build some relationship. We have our elders. I'm going to be there. I would encourage you, if you can make the time to hang out with us that weekend, make sure that you do it. Pastor Daniel mentioned Membership U. Membership U is very, very important to you, moving from your seats to actually engaging in the life of the church. I want to encourage you, if you haven't gone through Membership U, or maybe it's been a year or so since you have, maybe you're not connected, you're not serving somewhere, that is the place to get connected or reconnected as a member of the church. And so I want to encourage you to do that. Also, before we jump into the last one, I know there's lots of announcements, but we're going to be really digging deep into what the Bible says about what matters most. You know, many of the issues we're facing, they are not political issues, okay? You're being gaslit. They're actually moral issues that until 5 seconds ago, everyone understood the answer because their life was built on a Judeo-Christian framework. And so I want to encourage you, if there was ever a time to invite somebody, invite them. You know, there are people that you know, they're starting to look around the world. They're starting to see what's happening. And they're starting to realize, hey, something's wrong, something's not working. These may be people who would never set foot into a church at any other time, okay? But they will when we're talking about something like this. I believe God's going to do something absolutely incredible in our time. But it's going to be as we stand as light salt to the earth. And so I want to encourage you, if there was ever a time to invite somebody where they would be receptive, invite them. We're going to be covering all different kinds of things. I do want to encourage you, do not miss the first week. Okay, I'll be opening up next week, and I'm just going to tell you, it'll blow your mind about some of the things that I've seen in Scripture and have, kind of relate to what's going on. It'll also be a great encouragement for you. So we're going to continue with the parable of the leaven or the yeast. Okay, I was told between services that there is a difference, and then I studied it, and I decided it was a distinction that didn't make a difference, okay? And so I'm going to go back and forth between leaven, right, and yeast, the parable of leaven. It is the shortest parable told by Jesus, and it teaches us so much about how God wants to change everything in our life and our world. You know, Luke 13, verse 20 through 21, this is the parable. Jesus also asked, "What else is the kingdom of God like? It is like the yeast a woman used in making bread. Even though she put only a little yeast in 3 measures of flour, it permeated every part of the dough." You know, like most modern people who go to grocery stores, I enjoy bread a lot. Like the bread from Texas Roadhouse, I'm just telling you, those little biscuit things, I mean, they're just incredible. I could like bathe in whatever butter they put on them. Come on. Like I go to Longhorn, you know, and I love their big old bread, and it's all different kinds of bread. You know, growing up, you know, I lived in rural Oklahoma. We were poor. We pretty much just had Wonder Bread. Come on. But as I started to get older, I started to realize, man, I love all kinds of bread. We discovered Meg's Bakery in Temple, and there's all kinds of different bread that you can have. And contrary to what I grew up thinking, I thought the shelf life of bread was 9 to 12 months. Because that's Wonder Bread. Come on. I don't know what they put in it, but it'll go the distance. But I realize is the best bread, right, is meticulously made. There's processes to making bread. To be honest, I had never really known the process until my wife started experimenting cooking, making sourdough bread. And she started doing, yeah, she's like a hippie now, total hippie now, total hippie. Making her bread. I'm going to draw the line at making our own soap. Come on, somebody. But she started kind of experimenting. She started getting online, and there's some health benefits to sourdough bread. And she started studying the different, you know, bases and the different things. And she would put it together, and man, it was like trial and error, you know? It's like she would get it, and maybe the yeast and the leaven wasn't really all that great. And so, you know, it was more like a cracker. Come on. It's more like a cracker. Like unleavened bread, you know, we use that for communion. Come on. But then she started getting a little better at it. And the yeast, depending on, you know, how well it would grow and it would do, would kind of make the bread rise in the oven. And you know, then she was talking to her sister and she had gotten it to a certain place. Like it was pretty good, but the truth is it was still a little dense. You know, I could still knock out someone with it. Come on, just a little bit. And she'd gotten to this place where she was frustrated. She's figuring out, her sister said that she had gotten a starter kit, whatever it is. And this one went back generations. It had been continued through a family for generations, literally 3 or 4 generations. It was decades old. And Kyla, I'm sitting there thinking, that's kind of musty. I mean, my 9 to 12 month Wonder Bread, I mean, 30 years, that's a lot longer, you know? And she used it, and it was unbelievable. The oven was turned on. I mean, it was literally growing outside of the pan. The starter, she has to, like, work on it every other day because it's, like, bubbling out of the jar. This is the picture that Jesus gives us and the work that he does in our life. Amen. And for the next few moments, we're going to talk about all kinds of things this fall. Some of the things are going to make you uncomfortable. Some of you, you're going to be super mad at me. Be mad at the Bible. I'll still give you a hug and be your friend. Okay? One day you'll get to heaven. The Lord will show you how wrong you were. It'll be fine. Okay? We're not going to agree on everything. I'm going to push the envelope, which is exactly what believers have been doing for 2,000 years. We are to be the conscience of the culture we're in. We are to seek the welfare of the nation we're in. We have a responsibility to Christ, but we also, as we're going to see today, have a responsibility to allow that leaven, that yeast, to move through our own lives, and yes, even into our culture and the public square. But if there was ever a time to kind of set your heart, I want you to reconsider what you think your faith is and what it's meant to accomplish in the next few moments. A lot of us, we look at everything going on in our world, and we can begin to curse the darkness, shake our fist at the world. It's just so dark, it's just so bad, when the reality is, I believe we're living in the greatest time on planet Earth. The potential for people to come to Christ. I hear stories talking about revival happening in some of the darkest places in the world. Places in China where it's literally outlawed, right? The church there is exploding. I heard from a friend not too long ago that there's massive revival happening in Iran. There's nobody to share the gospel in Iran. But people are here having accounts of Jesus himself showing up and sharing the gospel with these people. God is doing incredible things. And we need to make sure that we understand, right, our relationship with him and its effect in our world as we go into a time that I believe is unprecedented. This is interesting about leaven and yeast, or yeast for some of you picky people. Right, this is the thing. You don't notice it when you mix it into the bread. You only notice it when you turn up the heat in the oven. And I believe we're coming to a time where there's lots of people who say, yeah, I'm saved, yeah, I'm a Christian, but they don't actually have the yeast of heaven in them. And when the heat turns up, they just burn to a crisp, but believers, we rise. I believe that that's what God is teaching us here. And I think if we can get kind of a bigger picture of our faith, I think it'll prepare us for what's ahead. Three ways that we learn what the kingdom of God is like in this parable. First, the kingdom of God is first established in us. It starts with you. God establishes his kingdom inside of us, in our spirit, in our hearts, the moment we surrender our lives to Jesus. This is the work of salvation. This is supernatural. This is why Jesus told Nicodemus, we'll call him Nick for short, right? When Nick asked, what do I got to do to see the kingdom of God? He was doing all of the stuff, but something was still missing in his life. And this is what Jesus said to him in John 3:3. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Unless you are born again. You might remember Nick's response. He was a physical man. You see, he fell for the trap that he thought the only thing that was real was what he could sense with his senses. But Jesus was alluding him to another reality, the spirit reality. You see, when you were created by God, the Bible says you were created in his image. Doesn't it stand the reason that if you're created in his image, you'll reflect him? Well, you do. The Bible says that God is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. This is the idea of the Trinity. We'll cover that another day. But he's all one, all equally God and equally unique. You're made the same way. Paul tells us in Thessalonians that you are spirit, soul, and body. And this is so important as the starting place for everything. Because when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, the Bible says that they died. Obviously, we read their story and we see that it wasn't physically, that was spiritually. The Bible says that through their bloodline, we are all born into this earth with our spirit dead. Now, this is very important because the Bible says that it's our spirit that connects with God because God is spirit. You see, your soul and your body, that's what's ruining our world right now. People that aren't spiritual, right? They're not engaging in the spiritual battle. They're just soul and body people just doing whatever feels good. It's true if it feels good. Your feelings aren't fact and many times aren't true. They'll lead you astray. Your emotions, your experiences, they may inform you, but they'll lead you to build your life in such a way that it'll come crashing down when the storm comes, when the heat's turned up. You see, when you give your life to Christ, the Bible says that you are born again. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead, the spirit of adoption, the Holy Spirit, that's one of his many names, comes to live inside of you. It's that deposit of yeast or leaven. And you know, when it first happens, there are lots of things that happened in my life when I gave my life to Christ. I mean, I'll tell you, my want to changed. But can I just tell you, my soul and body were pretty much the same. Yeah. And it took lots of time for it to take root. There were lots of moments, years even, where you couldn't even tell that the leaven was there, but it was still doing its work one day at a time through this process of sanctification, being conformed, molded into the image of Christ, growing, walking towards him, sin falling off, until one day, when not if pressure came, all of a sudden you could see what was really there. This is the power of the gospel. We can never stop sharing the gospel, ever. It is the answer from Genesis to Revelation, the story of God's plan to seek and save lost people, and it is so important. We don't compromise the truth. The Bible says that it is truth and grace that's needed. Truth comes first. It's easy to be gracious when people know the truth. It's not when they're trying to push lies and darkness. First, it takes root in your life. We need to worry about our life before anyone else. What's God doing in you? What's he called you to do? It takes root in conversations about faith that plant seeds in people's hearts. What about an act of selflessness that changes someone's perspective, a faithful prayer for somebody far from God? We can never underestimate those moments, those times. Matthew chapter 11, verse 30 says, "For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." How in the world can we be in this world but not of this world? How in the world can we have all of these things going on around us but a peace which surpasses all understanding in us? It's our own personal relationship with Christ. And although your faith is deeply personal, it was never meant to be private. This moves to the second point that I have today. The kingdom of God gets worked into every aspect of our life. You see, the leaven, the yeast, it doesn't stop. It first is established in us, and then it works its way in every part of our life. It starts with us and then others. The power of the gospel to change lives is profound. It's pervasive, much like how a little leaven leavens the whole lump of dough. The message of Jesus Christ has the power to transform individual hearts and consequently whole societies. And make no mistake, that is the purpose of your faith. It's not just a practice your faith in the four walls. It's not just to kind of hide it or put it under a lamp, put it under a shelf, cover it. No, it's meant to have its effect in the world. We've got to begin to take that seriously. Next, the kingdom of God is meant to change everything around us. It's meant to change everything around us. Can I just say, the culture wars are the Christian responsibility. We see this 2,000 years of history. It was this way. Shining a light in the darkness, being persecuted for. This is interesting in the early church. God added while they were in Jerusalem. They were in their safe place, but God wanted to take the message to the Gentiles all the way out of the kingdom. The Bible says God, the Holy Spirit was moving. There were problems. They were solving them, but the Lord added, and then persecution fell on the church at Jerusalem. And after that, the Bible says that they multiplied, and they spread into the entire earth. You know, sometimes when you're just getting started in your faith, it's just kind of like, I'm just adding. It's kind of slow. Addition's a little slower. And for many of you, like me, I need to subtract some stuff too. Come on. There's some things I'm kind of subtracting, and then I'm adding, then I'm subtracting, and then I'm adding. But then there comes a point where it takes root, and it begins to work through your life. It's no longer about you. It's your marriage. It's your family. It's your job. You begin to walk different. Begin to shine a great light. It's meant to work in every aspect of our lives, and it changes everything around us. Matthew 5, 13 through 15. Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth, but what good is salt if it's lost its flavor? Can you make it salty again? It will be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house." Here's what I would say. A faith that isn't practiced in the public square isn't a true faith to begin with. We've got to get out of this false, you know, doctrine of niceness, doctrine of tolerating the darkness that literally destroys people. You know why God hates sin? Because he loves people. Sin hurts people. You know why we stand boldly and proclaim the truth? So that when people see the truth, they can turn. And in that moment, guess what? All the grace comes in. You can't change your past any more than you can unscramble eggs. Neither can the people who repent. There's great grace in that. But grace without truth won't work. It's actually cruel and it's wrong. Three things that light does. The first thing that light does is light allows us to see the truth. We must shine light in the darkness because people in darkness are blind. Remember, turning on the lights in a dark space is disruptive, but it is also beneficial. When you've been in darkness for so long, then you turn on the light, it's a little disorienting, isn't it? Your eyes have to adjust. Do you know what the grace of God allows in the life of a believer and those walking things out? It allows time for our eyes to adjust. You know, sometimes you'll hear something, and the enemy's plan is close off your heart. Bigot, racist, walk out the door. You've just severed all of the light. You know what happens when you remain? And you say, okay, God, there was something in me that just did this. Ooh. It could be him. He could be a total idiot. Could be. But I'm going to open up your word, and I'm going to allow your spirit to speak to me. I'm going to allow my eyes to adjust. You know what happens when your eyes adjust? You begin to see things clearly, not emotionally. You don't react, but you begin to obey and listen and cooperate with the work of God in your life and in the life of other people. And in the life of other people. John 12:36, put your trust or faith in the light while there is still time. Then you will become children of the light. Psalm 119:105, your word is a lamp to guide my feet and a light for my path. You know, many times, here's what we focus on, even as believers. Oh man, the Bible says I can't do that. The Bible says that's wrong. Oh man, I feel convicted. I slipped and fell on my face. The Bible's going to take away from me. It takes away all my fun. We say this. We say this to our kids. You know what? Just go to college and have fun before you get married. I'm sorry if your marriage isn't fun, but that's not a biblical attitude. We have these attitudes that have crept into the church, crept into our life, and it's because we have this negative view of what when God tells us to do something. We're like, he's just like hitting us, it's like a school marm, hitting us with a ruler. No, he's trying to help us identify where we are so he can tell us where to go, and it's better. You see, God never tells you not to do something without saying, hey, do this. This is better. Your word is a lamp to guide my feet. Why is that important? You need to know where your feet are. James says the word of God is a mirror to show us who God is and who we are in relation so that we can change. We're foolish if we walk away and forget what we look like in that mirror. We have to know where our feet are to know where God's called us to go. Look, but it's also a light for my path. We don't focus on the light for my path. You know where you are? Okay, great. God meets you where you are, but he won't leave you there. God wants you to go so much further. This is the difference between empathy and compassion, by the way. Empathy says, I just want to hug you in your pain. You know, there's some value to being able to attempt to put yourself in someone's shoes and consider how they're feeling. But there's no value in staying there because they feel like crap. You meet them there so that you can go and walk with them somewhere else. The Bible says Jesus had compassion on people. What does that mean? He taught them. You can be more than you possibly think you can be in Christ. To follow him is so much greater than to follow this world and this system. Your word is a lamp to guide my feet, and it's a light for my path. That path is so much better. Next, light exposes darkness. If you notice, darkness doesn't like to be exposed. But where there's light, it can't win. It can't triumph. Ephesians 5:11. Through 14, take no part in the worthless deeds of evil and darkness. Instead, expose them. Doesn't say tolerate them. Doesn't say smile at them, invite them in and cuddle them. It says expose them. It's better to be in the light. When you study trees, you know, plants, we have some places in our house that get lots of sunlight. In other places, it's like a little dungeon. It's like little closets, you know. And we have to pick what kind of plant we want to put in which place. Where there's light, the plants are always bigger, they're prettier, they bloom better. Where it's dark, they're always small. They're not very nice. They're just kind of, you know, succulents. It's like they're just sucking on for dear life. Come on, somebody. They look good, but ain't no fruit coming off those trees. It takes lots of light. Living in the light's better. You know, my 12-year-old daughter hates it when I turn on the lights in the morning. She hates it. She screeches like a vampire back under the covers. And I sing an obnoxious song that I'm not going to sing because I want you to come back to the church. If you leave because you're offended by Jesus, that's good. If you're offended by me, that's not good. But I know it's better for her to get up, put her clothes on, and to participate in life in the light. It's always better. It's always better. But they don't like it. It's shameful even to talk about the things that ungodly people do in secret, but their evil intentions will be exposed when the light shines on them, for the light makes everything visible. This is why it is said, awake, O sleeper, rise up from the dead, and Christ will give you light. This book, men and women for the last 2,000 years have lived this. This is our birthright. This is our inheritance as believers. Before then, it was 5,000 plus years of our Jewish brothers and sisters that we read about. David, Samson, Gideon, Esther, Mordecai. You read these stories, and you think to myself, they're superheroes. No, they're not. They just refused to lie. They told the truth. They stood even when they had no idea what was going to happen. They had no idea if they were going to make it. We have the benefit of reading their stories after. But the Bible says they're up in heaven now on grandstands cheering us on, because unlike them, the Bible says we have the yeast of the Holy Spirit alive in us. You see, the Holy Spirit came upon them, was with them, cooperated, right, in their circumstances, but didn't reside in them. That is reserved solely for the church. The Bible calls the church the bride of Christ. It is a big deal. God has so much planned for you, but we can never shy back from the light exposing the darkness. Next, light promotes spiritual growth and health. Spiritual growth and health in the same way that natural light is essential for the process of photosynthesis in a plant, spiritual light is required for growth and health and human flourishing. So watch your inputs. I didn't say this in the last service, but I'm going to say it in this one. I don't know why. We have to change our inputs. Many of us, our lives are dark. Our spirits within us are dark. We're plagued by depression, by anxiety, by fear. And the truth of the matter is, the Bible says faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. What are you listening to? What are you watching? Right? Change that. I promise you it'll change everything in your life. As you allow life, listen, it's not going to be easy at first because you got some ingrained habits. You know, that Netflix in, that you've got some ingrained habits. Binge watching shows. You know, bringing in inputs. Some of these are going to be relationships. You're going to have to change. You're going to have to allow more light into your life. But can I tell you, it's better to live in the light than it is in the darkness. And you do it one step, one decision at a time. Light promotes spiritual growth and health. Jesus says this in John 8, 12. Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. Ephesians 5, 9, for this light within you, everyone say me, it's within everyone who believes, produces only what is good, right, and true. John 1, 5, the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness can never extinguish it. Matthew 4, 16, and in the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. The first time the church is mentioned by Jesus. Jesus had been doing his ministry. They started to see that he did signs and wonders that were only prophecies of the Messiah. They began to experience incredible things, but people still wondered. They still wavered. You see, a lot of people say, if we just see a sign, I'll believe there's a God. No, you won't. If you can't have faith, when you don't see, you won't have it when you do. And their disciples are walking. Jesus takes them way out of the way to the most wicked place on planet Earth at the time. It was known or thought to be the gates of hell or Hades. It was a cave in Caesarea Philippi where they would literally sacrifice tens of thousands of children every year. Good Jews never went there. I can imagine his 12 disciples were incredibly nervous as they were getting closer. 2,500 steps, you know, or camel lengths to Caesarea Philippi. And he starts asking his disciples a question along the way. They were a little nervous. They're getting closer to this wicked place. They want to walk in the other direction. And he starts asking the question, who do men say that I am? In other words, what's the word on Twitter and Facebook? Well, they start answering. Some say you're Elijah. Some say you're a prophet. Some people say you're a really good guy. Other people have t-shirts that say you're their homeboy. And then he comes to this place, the most wicked place on planet Earth. I've been in Israel. There are places you walk in Israel. You walk by, I walked by this one place. It was a pile of rocks. I walked by it. And I turned to the guide. He hadn't even opened his mouth to tell us what it is. I said, this place feels really evil.
And he says, yes, that's where children used to be sacrificed. You can still feel the presence of that evil. Pass by a Planned Parenthood, you still feel the same thing. And takes them right up to that place that none of them want to be. And then he says, he asks the only question that matters, and I'm going to ask you this question. Who do you say that I am? Peter didn't get it right many times, but God revealed it. And Peter says, you're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, on that rock, I will build my church. The word's ecclesia. It's the same word that's used for community building, for political building. It's the same thing. Guess what? It's going to be the force that brings kingdom culture into an evil world and ultimately is transformed through it. I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I want to ask you this question for all of you who think in your mind, maybe still in your emotions, I don't know about us getting all involved. I mean, there's a lot of risk, right? There's a lot of risk. I don't know if Christians should be speaking up about their faith. Maybe we just need to keep in the four walls. I mean, maybe there really are two things you should never talk about in family, you know, politics and religion. It's interesting. That's a lie from the pit of hell too. Those are the two most important things that affect your life. Your faith. And your ability to be free. Are you kidding me? We have this attitude, but I want you to think about where he established his church. See, he wasn't on a bunker in Montana. He wasn't in some church under a steeple. He was literally at the gates of hell. You know where the church belongs? Right in front of the most wicked things in culture. Listen, here's what happens. When we're not where we're supposed to be, darkness takes over. And yet, when we're where we're supposed to be, it's forced to flee. We need to think about that as we engage this next season, as we prioritize our faith this fall. Let me pray for you. God, I thank you so much for the power of your word. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in our church family. It's absolutely incredible to see what you're doing in our world. You could have picked any time on planet Earth to put us here, and you picked this time. For such a time as this, it was true for Esther in her day, and it's true for us in our day. You want to do incredible things in and through us, but you require our participation, our faith. I pray that you would continue to speak to us where we are. You would give us wisdom, discernment on how to arrange and rearrange our life to make time to be made new by your word, for faith to grow in our lives. I also pray, Father, for anybody in here that doesn't know you, I pray, Father, that they would not leave this place the same way that they came in. They would leave changed. As heads are bowed, eyes are closed, we're almost finished. One of the things we do in every location, in every service, every time, is we provide a place and a space for people who are far from God to make a decision not to be. As heads are bowed, eyes are closed, listen, I don't have to thump you with my Bible. I don't have to call you up and embarrass you, single you out. You know if you're playing with God or not. Nobody needs to tell you that. You know it. And my answer to you is that you'll never be all that you were created to be apart from the one who made you. You can't get to him apart from the person of Jesus, who lived a perfect life, the life you could never live. He died on a cross that paid for every wicked thing you've ever done, are doing, or will do. And ultimately, he rose from the dead to give you a hope and a future, not just in the next life, but in this life. And God's not a tyrant. He's not a bully. He's not going to possess you, force you, push you. You have to choose him or reject him. God says, let heaven and earth witness, today I have laid before you life and death, blessing and cursing. God says, oh, that you would choose life so it would go good for you and those who come after you. God wants you to choose life, but many don't. It's because they never take the step to accept what the Bible says about Jesus is true and to put their faith to believe in him. Maybe at some point you gave your life to Christ, but you're not walking with him today. Maybe you've never done that because of your own pride. But as I've opened up the Word of God, you've realized through the conviction of the Holy Spirit, this is your step. In a moment, I'm going to pray for you. And if you'd say today, Pastor, I'm far from God, I don't want to be, and you would want my prayer, would you acknowledge that by lifting your hand? Is there anybody in here like that? Just lift your hand up halfway for me. I see you. Thank you. Is there anyone else? You say, Pastor, that's me. I see you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hands are going up all over the room. Thank you. Thank you. Jesus makes a statement, thank you, that those who acknowledge me before the Father, or acknowledge me before men, I'll acknowledge before the Father, but those who don't, I won't. Is there anyone else? You say, Pastor, that's me. I'm far from God. I want to be included in your prayer. I see you. Thank you. Thank you. I see you. Thank you. In a moment, I'm going to lead you in a prayer right where you're sitting. One of the things you have to understand is this prayer is not a parking spot. It's not a get to heaven free card. It's an initial decision of faith to follow him. Whether or not it sticks depends on whether or not you follow through and you show up and you continue to grow and move forward. We want to help you with that. We're going to give you some steps after we pray in a moment for you to get planted into the church. The Bible says when you give your life to Christ, you're born again. Show me a baby that's left by the side of the road and survives, and I'll show you a Christian that doesn't need the church. You want your faith to survive, you have to plant into the church. But it starts with you putting your hope, faith, your belief in Christ. In a moment, I'm going to lead you in a prayer right where you're sitting. If you really meant it, allow this prayer to be an on-ramp for God to meet you where you are and to take you where he wants you to go. Say this prayer just loud enough where you can hear your own voice. It's a prayer based on the Bible, Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10. Church, we're going to pray this prayer so as to encourage their faith. I believe it's the power of God to change your life. If you believe, let's pray this prayer together. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for coming to this earth, for living a perfect life. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. I believe that you are good, and I believe you're God. I believe on the third day, after you were killed on the cross, I believe you rose from the dead. I believe you conquered death once and for all to give me life once and for all. And so today, of my own free will, I choose to make you my Lord, my Savior, and my King. Lead me and guide me. Show me what's next. It's in your name that I pray. And everybody said, amen, amen. Come on, church. Let's put our hands together for all those who did that.